Yeah. I like it when I sneak up on motherfuckers. March 17th, actually, that went into the 18th, 2005, was the official announcement that the Bandit is back. I think what I want to do now is explain what happened at a certain period when I left Cleveland coming to New York. I had a band that was really, we was deep in the basement. But we worked our way all the way from Cleveland up to New York as a group. We was called Black on Black. Young boys really looking to chase their dream and everything. But I was the only one in position to sort of head hunt and, you know, spearhead the energy, you know. But Roy Ayers brought us, Roy Ayers, I love Roy. Roy Ayers brought me really to New York City. I relate to Harlem more than I even do Cleveland, but I relate to Harlem. And I believe this is the second renaissance. But you know, this is a wealth of Black American culture here in Harlem, and we can't let it die because everybody else is here now. We need to get here. But Arthur Prysock brought some visions to me that I'll never forget that was directly hooked to the Harlem Renaissance, because he was there. Red Fox, I got to work with Red Fox and be around him and Red Fox, Slappy White, amongst millions and millions of other people. And Prysock was truly a special spirit in Harlem, and a special spirit with the women. Oh, Arthur Prysock was God's gift to women. He's so smooth. But people don't really know what all he had to deal with, Fox and all of them. But they all stuck together, and I think we got to get back into there. And it started moving around, you know. Then I started working my way into the Village Clique, you know, which is supposed to be the mainstream and jazz, you know, the Vanguard, the Village Gate, all that stuff, you know. I did a lot of them things and made me a respect on that scene. But it still wasn't the same to me like being in Harlem, you know. I've always, as long as I live, and I've always been, maybe should I say this? Anyway, the people, I'm about my folks, you know, I'm about the hood. You know, I really want to say the N-word, but since this might be educational, I'll, expose a little class. But I'm just about down-to-earth, home-style people. I mean, I love family, I love the wino, I love the number man, I love the preacher, I love... So many different people I've had so much. You know, that's really my wealth. I know I was lucky a few times to make a little money. And it didn't mean nothing because I messed it up. Right? But the real deal is I'm filthy rich with real love. I'm not talking about sex now. I mean, people love me no matter where they at. And that's the feeling I love, you know. And what's the difference if you buy a Mercedes or you ride a Mercedes, you know? But, you know, all that material possession, in the long run, yes, it does have value. It ain't the answer. If you're not spiritually hooked up to what's happening now, you will not survive. You know, and that's been evident in all the powers to be a baller. Meanwhile, I'm gonna keep doing what I come to do the first time. Pharrell Sanders turned me so much knowledge and everything. Pharrell Sanders. Matter of fact, if it wasn't for Pharrell Sanders, I wouldn't have seen my father's funeral. You know, it's a long story. You can get it in the book. But Pharrell Sanders really put a ton of stuff on me.
Musicians come from everywhere to come and sit in on jam sessions. Great musicians, great jazz musicians, great blues musicians. And they all knew Greg Bandy.
Betty Carter was like a big sister. She was high energetic. She became institutional in the development of young black artists like Art Blakey was, but after Blakey, Betty took over. That was another blessing. I mean, I've been really overly loaded with blessings. Youssef Lateef was a monster. So much knowledge on the business and all that kind of stuff. Oh, but I loved it. He wasn't scared to create and take chances, you know. But I mean, I could go on and on and on. Gloria Lynn, Lil' Jimmy Scott, Ruth Brown. I was lucky to play all the ends of the deal. Freddie Hubbard, Stanley Turrentine. Herbie Hancock was my neighbor when I first got here. We lived upstairs from Herbie, you know.
We are the ones that support each other. Musicians stick together. Musicians give each other. Musicians, if I got a gig, you got a gig. If I make whatever, you can get part of that. We try to keep each other going because the industry a lot of times doesn't support us like we should be supported. But as a musician, there's nothing he wouldn't do for his Harlem friends, because Harlem is so much of who he is. He loves it, he breathes it, he believes in it, he trusts it, and he's about reviving it. Harlem is the epitome of the Renaissance period, and all the musicians and artists and educators and ministers and doctors and all the prestigious people that were in this area when Greg came to Harlem, and still are. And that is something that he always would cherish, he does cherish. And as a person that cherishes Harlem, its history, and its people, this is something that he will always be about, because this is his heart.